When I came to Middlemore, the first thing I noticed was the difference in the people that we were seeing. So a lot of the people that I saw in the UK were from a white working class background, rural background. So a lot of elderly immigrants. And the difference here is that the immigrants tend to come after their adult children have come. So often they don't have English, whereas in the UK they may have been in England for 50, 60 years, so there's some English there. So that made quite a lot of difference to me. I'm using interpreters a lot. The other thing is I work at the memory service, and anecdotally we felt that Maori and Pacific presented at an earlier age, but maybe that she looked at the data. So I started thinking, well, so what is the prevalence of dementia in New Zealand, and is there any difference amongst the major ethnic groups? And now, is that due to different risk factor profiles? 2017, I took up my post as senior lecturer at the University of Auckland, so this became my research area of interest. The first thing I did as a good researcher was start doing some background literature review. There is very little on dementia research in New Zealand. This is the Deloitte updated economic impact report, which is brought out every 5 years about the economic impact of dementia. And basically they take data that has been from Australia and Europe and then extrapolate it to the New Zealand population. So it's not real data, it's all modelled on other people's data. It doesn't take any account of the unique population differences in New Zealand, it doesn't take any account of the fact that maybe people are presenting at early age. So, as there wasn't very much to find, we're back to the county's memory service. I'll just tell you a little bit about this. We take referrals from primary care and secondary care, mostly geriatricians. We don't cover the eastern sector, and that's the kind of traditional, not quite sure why, but they tend to go to the geriatric clinics. So we don't see many people from Chinese backgrounds in the memory service. That's worth taking into account. We see people at home with interpreters if you need to. We take a history from the person, a history from their family, and we test their cognition, talk to them about their activities of daily living. They also get blood tests and a scan and so on. We take all of that data back to our multidisciplinary team meeting at here on a weekly basis and make a diagnosis. And all the data gets entered into a spreadsheet, and it was a lot of data was being entered into that spreadsheet, not so much now. So we decided to look at it. So what we found was over the 4 years, between 2013 and 2016, so that's the full 4 years, we had 1,100 people referred to the memory service. Mean age at referral was about 75 years, and 42% were male. So we had about 40% Pakeha, 26% Pacific, 16% Maori, and 5% Asian, 12% other unknown. And 785 of those were actually assessed by the service. The remainder were either diverted to other services or they declined to be seen. 74 were required an interpreter, and 65 of those 74 were from Pacific lands. So 60% of the people that we saw had dementia. 77% of those had a new diagnosis, so they'd never been diagnosed before. 13% had mild cognitive impairment. And 17% their diagnosis was deferred because they had either a medical or psychiatric illness which may be causing their cognitive impairment. So that was treated first. And 10% had no diagnosis. So we have a sample of 360 patients with a new diagnosis of dementia, and these are the ones that we looked at in more detail. So our sample size, 40% Pakeha, 35% Pacific, 12% Maori. I'm not going to look at this group because it's such a heterogeneous group in terms of ethnicity but also types of dementia and so on. And these are the groups that we're actually interested in. So the most striking finding was the difference in age. So Pakeha presented at a mean age of 79, Pacific 74, and Maori 70. So that's a 9-year age difference. That's univariate, so we have to take into account from family factors. Majority of people were female in each group, which isn't surprising because females live longer and are more likely to get dementia. There were less males in the Pacific group, but that wasn't significant. Dementia severity is interesting. So the majority of people that come to the memory service have mild dementia, so they're in the early stages. But what we found in the Pacific group was that more people had moderate to severe dementia, which means that they're presented later in the disease process. The dementia subtypes, majority have, or the most common was Alzheimer's disease, followed by mixed dementia, which is mixed Alzheimer's and vascular, and then vascular dementia. But again, and other dementias is, again, a whole hodgepodge, you have onset dementia, primary progressive aphasia, Huntington's, frontotemporal dementia. So it's a bit difficult to make any analysis from that. But again, vascular dementia was more common amongst Maori compared to the other groups, and mixed dementia was more common amongst the Pacific. But these could be just due to confounding factors, so we wanted to look at the multivariate analyses. And so again, other dementia is the youngest dementia, and that's not surprising because some of it is young onset dementia, that's under 65. Then Alzheimer's disease, vascular dementia, and mixed dementia. Again, not surprising because as we get older, our brains get more pathology, so we're more likely to have Alzheimer's pathology, more likely to have vascular pathology, so it's going to be more likely that you get diagnosed with mixed dementia. But again, the most striking finding is the age differences here. In all dementias, Māori were the youngest, Pacific the next youngest, and Papua the oldest. So the differences are between 7 and 10 years. This is, I mean, these are really quite marked differences. So why might that be? So we look at the alternative reasons, so sort of bias, confounding factors, chance, and so on, first of all. So this could be a selective sample. Maybe we're very good at encouraging younger Māori and Pacific to come to our memory service. But in fact, the sample is very representative of the county's population, so we don't think that that is the case in terms of proportions. It could be clinician bias in terms of dementia severity and subtype. It may be that if you have a clinician that is using an interpreter, they're more likely to interpret them. Diagnose different dementias. It could be chance, but the p-values for age are less than 0.001, so it's very unlikely. Or it could be a real effect. And, I'll just come back to that. So there have been very few studies across the world, but there have been some studies in indigenous populations in Canada, Australia, United States, Guam, and Brazil, and they found the same findings, that the dementia seems to be brought forward. Possible reasons for this might be genetic differences, socioeconomic risk factors, and medical risk factors. Factors we don't know in New Zealand, so to find that we need to do a proper population-based New Zealand dementia prevalence study, which we'll launch in February. So just some pictures of the fun that we had. Lots of different communities came and played ukuleles and did dances. And our timeline is to get all of the development work done in the next 3 years in order to try and have sufficient work for a dementia prevalence study in 2020 or 2021. But coming back to research, it's very gratifying. We've finally got it published in the International Journal of Geriatric Psychiatry, which is a good journal. And just to acknowledge Kate Mullin, who was a consultant. A consultant psychiatrist here a couple of years ago. She started the research, we're joint first authors. Irene was a statistician who was working in the department here but moved over to university of Auckland. Susan Yates was a psychologist and she collected all the baseline data and which made this possible. Vahid Payman, Mark Fisher were both working here as consultants in object psychiatry, and Gary Chung is consultant at ADHD and an academic as well. So, thank you very much.